you love me, please don't judge me. Got my hands tied, the power's above me. Don't shoot the messenger, I'm just a puppet here. If you wanna place blame, then look to the puppeteer. Family, fortune, envy, jealousy, privilege, passed on, legacy, secret, sabotage, borderline, felony, suicide, subtract, selfish, pedigree, yeah.
So it's that weekend. One of the most anticipated races on the schedule has happened this weekend. It's always a big deal when a new track comes onto the schedule, especially when it's a fan favorite short track in Xfinity and trucks that fans have been saying for years should have been a cup date for a long time. Hell, for years I've been saying Iowa should have had a cup date for years. And it finally happened. I believe originally this was supposed to be Montreal, but we'll just say shit hit the fan on that deal and it fell through. But Iowa took the place and stepped up to the challenge, and well, I'd say despite a couple minor nip issues, which were a couple nitpicks to be honest, the weekend did deliver, and Iowa delivered, the fans showed up. Like, Iowa this weekend, in my opinion, was an absolute success. And we'll touch on those minor nitpicks for Cup in a little bit. But for now, let's take a look at how everything went for Iowa this weekend.
I'm calling both games!
So starting off, we had the ARCA race at Iowa, which was also a combined race. It also counted for the ARCA East Championship as well. So yeah, this race, it was mainly a two-man battle in this race between Connor Zilich and William Solowich, as those two are in that three-way title fight for the ARCA East Championship, along with Giovanni Ruggiero, as those three were really the class of the field throughout much of this race. It's kind of sad, though, especially with the ARCA Championship right now, because let's be honest, the three best drivers in ARCA this year right now are Connor Zilich, William Solowich, and Giovanni Ruggiero. There's one problem when it comes to main ARCA. Those three can't run the full ARCA schedule because those three aren't 18 yet. Damn it. Because the ARCA championship has been a fucking crapshoot this year. Like, let's be honest, this championship is such a crapshoot. It's honestly the main ARCA title, the main ARCA championship. It's becoming the championship nobody wants to win this year. Like, I'll just say this here. Whoever wins the ARCA title this year wins it by fucking default because nobody wants to win it. And it might be Andreas Perez de Lair. Like, if he wins the title this year, he wins it by default. Because nobody wanted to win it. Plus, the three best drivers in the series can't run full-time because they're not 18 yet. But, yeah. But anyway, though, on the final restart, Zilich would get past Solowich, and then he'd hold off Solowich and company. And Connor Zilich gets his third win of the season. Holy shit, Connor Zilich has done it again. Connor Zilich has done it again. Holy shit, Connor Zilich is becoming the man in ARCA. Like he seems to be Toyota's kryptonite when it comes to the ARCA series. But yeah, now Connor Zilich got some more breathing ground between him and Solowich in the ARCA East Championship as Andreas Perez de Lara continues to pad his lead. Like, seriously, who's the next best per driver at ARCA that could maybe challenge him? Maybe Amber Bowson? And she's been pretty mediocre at best this year, at least around average to below average. Which I'm surprised she's still doing the full ARCA schedule. I thought she would have gone to the fucking Canada series full time, but I guess not. But yeah, and of course, the big talk after the race was William Solowich's interview, where Solowich complained about Zilich trying to check him down on a restart, and then Solowich saying he lost respect for Zilich. Dude, you tried to literally dump his ass three times right after, man. You have no fucking room to talk about respect when you're trying to dump his ass repeatedly after that. Like, Jesus Christ, I love William Solowich, but man, why is it that every fucking young Toyota driver worth a fucking damn from the TRD program ends up turning to some little crybaby bitch? God damn it. Can we have a fucking Toyota prospect that isn't a fucking crybaby bitch when it comes to hard racing? God damn it. I mean, the good news is he's still very young and he's not 18 yet. So, you know, best to teach them to err their ways now while they're young and dumb. You know, so yeah, definitely. Also, I'll say this. I like Solowich, but that if a kid, you have a long way to go with your maturity. He's got a long way to go. He's got a lot of growing up to do. But, you know, there's still hope for him since he's still extremely young. I mean, Jesse Love was a crybaby bitch for a little bit when he complained about hard racing, but then he grew the fuck up and he matured, and look how he's doing in Xfinity. So, yeah, hey, if Jesse Love can turn his life, can mature and turn it around, then Solowich sure as hell can. Time will tell, though, but it's on Solowich to mature. Could he mature? 100%, but it's on him. Time will tell, though. But congrats to Zillich, though, as there's no maturity issues with him there. Now to the Xfinity race in Iowa. Well, this Xfinity race was pretty interesting. There was a lot of tire failures in this race, a lot of comers and goers, and a lot of different pitch strategies, especially with the tire wear and all that. Like, so many tire failures took out a lot of favorites in this race. Just very crazy, and yeah, a lot of tire failures. And all I say is, well, whatever tire issues the Cup Series was having, it's now made its way into the fucking Xfinity Series, too. And I guess this will most likely put an end to everybody crying and complaining about single lug nut tires now, because everyone, because I've heard everyone that complained about saying,
oh, go back to 5-lug nut tires, they said. Oh, 5-lug nut tires don't have the same issues that single lug nut tires have, they say.
All I say is, well, it's good to know that now Goodyear doesn't just fuck up in Cup Series, they fuck up in Xfinity as well. Just, yeah, so many tire failures, especially, like, after, like, 30, 40 laps, they just, tire just goes boom. But, yeah, just very crazy. Like, I don't really call it an issue at Iowa, because we've seen tire issues happen almost at any other track under the right circumstances. So, it's honestly more of a minor nitpick, but throughout most of this race, the first half of this race was dominated by Chandler Smith, as Chandler had a car to beat until he got put in the back in the third stage, and then once Chandler ended up in the back, he just never could get back to the front and never really got back up there. We also saw some other favorites like Allgaier, who looked pretty good early on, get taken out. Even Austin Hill, who looked good at one point, had tire issues, and he was taken out. And as and also, it's also kind of fitting to hear the crowd cheer for Austin Hill when Austin Hill crashed out and cheering for his misfortune, considering that this track was also the same place where Ultimate 23 Karen's hatred for Austin Hill began back in that truck race in 2019 when Hill and Johnny Sauter got in that pissing match. Which ended with Sauter intentionally wrecking Hill under caution, and then Sauter deservingly getting a one-race suspension, and then getting the chase waiver shortly after. And Ultimate 23 Karen has hated Austin Hill since that day, along with his fan base. If he has anything left. But yeah, anyway, though, after that, though, we would then have Sam Mayer come up to the front in the closing laps. And then it looked like maybe John Hunter Nemechek had a chance near the end until he had a tire issue go down. But this one was caused by contact with Sheldon Creed on a restart, where he had a tire rub and eventually the tire went. Oh, well, so Sheldon Creed just doesn't race. So, Sheldon Creed also races teammates like an idiot at fucking JGR too, so it's not just an RCR problem. Maybe the problem at RCR was Sheldon Creed all along. I mean, there's a pretty good argument for it there too, considering that Jesse Love got a win in that two car, the one thing Sheldon Creed could never do. So yeah, there's an argument there that maybe the problem at RCR was Sheldon Creed. And maybe there's some justification for Austin Hill. Doesn't change the fact Austin Hill's still a bully, though. And an asshole. But anyway, continuing back to the race. The race would go to overtime where Sam Mayer would have to fight off Riley Herbst and Corey Hyman. Corey Hyman making a rare Xfinity start. But despite Hyman Herbst's best efforts, just Sam Mayer would not be denied. Sam Mayer would go on and get his second win of the season, winning at Iowa. And then after the race, Riley Herbst would get mad at Sam Mayer for trying to hold him up on the final restart. where Herbst would go over and cut Sam Mayer's left rear tire down. And that didn't even, and I was like, whatever Herbst was trying to prove, it didn't really work. Because Sam Mayer still did a burnout anyway with a flat left rear tire. All I say is, Riley Herbst, if you're going to try and stop Sam Mayer from doing a burnout, at least make sure you total his car first, because, yeah, cutting the tire down doesn't work. All I say is, you can cut his tire down all you want, Riley Herbst. There's one thing you can't cut down, and that's Sam Mayer's spot in the 2024 Xfinity Chase. Since now with two wins, Sam Mayer becomes the first junior motorsports driver to officially lock himself in the Xfinity Chase. And I say watch out for Sam Mayer in the chase this fall. I think Sam Mayer could be a legit title contender this year, and I think he's getting hot at the right time. So I say watch out for Mayer. I think he's getting hot at the right time. So with Sam Mayer locked in, we now have four spots officially decided in the Xfinity Chase for now. And eight spots still remain with 11 races to go. And don't worry, we're going to talk about the Xfinity Chase standings at the end of the video. Since now that we're in the NBC portion of the season, we're now going to pay attention to the Chase grid standings to see who will be in the Chase and who will be out. And who will get the right to compete for championships in respective series. But yeah, pretty good Xfinity race too. Minus the tire issues, but that's honestly more of a minor nitpick of anything. But yeah, anyway though, it's now time to talk about the Cup race, the inaugural Cup race at Iowa. Now to the main event, the Cup race at Iowa, the inaugural Cup race, a race a lot of people have been waiting a long-ass time for. Waiting a long time for this moment. And well, throughout much of this race, it was really only two cars in the class of their own. Like, it was mainly between Larson and Blaney for most of this race, especially the first two stages. With Blaney winning stage one, Larson winning stage two. Mainly Larson also showing that you can pass at this track with tires. Like, there are a lot of comers and goers and a lot of tire strategy in this race. Some guys taking two tires, some taking four, some just staying out for track position. But Larson proved that you can pass with the crappy short track package at this track. As at one point, Larson fell to 32nd because of a loose wheel and was able to work his way back up into the top five and then up to the lead. At one point, there was even going to be working at a 1-2-3 HMS until Daniel Hemric slid up into the wall and ruined the NASCAR side to be trigger-happy with the caution. Yeah, sliding out of the groove. That, like, I'll be honest, that Hemric incident, that was not worthy of a fucking caution. So not only were there tire issues in this race, we also had inconsistent, terrible NASCAR officiating as well. NASCAR and their officiating inconsistencies. Name a better combination. Like, it's fucking crazy with the inconsistency. Like, apparently that was a caution, but guys like Eric Jones and a few others blowing tires, nope, not a caution there. Nothing to see here. Just, yeah, vintage NASCAR and their inconsistent BS. And then, of course, on the last restart before the end of Stage 2, we almost had a close call between Stenhouse and Byron when Stenhouse got loose, when he stayed out and forced Byron to check up and lose a bunch of spots. But yeah, quite a few tire issues in this race. Like, one thing we saw was AJ Allmendinger had tire blowouts in both the Cup and Xfinity race. Oof, two tire blowouts in the same weekend. That's fucking brutal look. But of course, Larson's good fortunes would end near the start of Stage 3 when he went 3 wide between Suarez and Keselowski, and then Suarez would get loose after Larson decided to pull embraces inner Ayrton Senna and went for a gap that existed. Because remember the Ayrton Senna rule. If you no longer go for a gap that exists, then you're no longer a real race car driver. But in the end, it came at the cost of Suarez getting loose into Larson, and then Larson would spin into the wall collecting Denny Hamlin. Well, at least there's one positive out of that. And it's also kind of fitting that those two crash into each other, considering in Stage 2, Hamlin tried to dump Larson while Hamlin was a lap down. And when Larson was mad about it, we saw great leadership from Cliff Daniels to calm Larson down and to have him refocus on the task at hand. Like, honestly, that's great leadership from Cliff Daniels to tell Larson to let it go with Hamlin and to focus on the race. Like that leadership from Cliff Daniels, that proves why Cliff is easily the best crew chief in the sport, without a shadow of a doubt. And honestly, everyone should take notes from Cliff Daniels telling Larson to let it go, because I think a lot of fan bases need to let some shit go. Especially Ultimate 23 Karen when it comes to Austin Hill. But that's a topic for another day. But yeah, of course, Larson would make minimum speed, and then he would be allowed to go to the garage to fix any repairs. If anyone wondering how was Larson able to come back after having crash damage, well, it wasn't classified crash damage when he went to the garage. It was mechanical damage because Larson cleared the damaged vehicle policy. Which, after Larson cleared the policy, he then got a 2-lap penalty. Beep! For too many men over a while under the damaged vehicle policy. For anyone complaining, just be glad it's 2-lap. It's a 2-lap penalty, because the old penalty used to be where if you had too many men over the wall, you would be parked the rest of the race. So just be glad it's 2 laps instead of what it used to be. Like, you can complain about it all you want, but hey, it could have been worse. It could have been that bullshit that happened to Kenseth in 2017, where you get parked the rest of the race. But Larson was able to make it back on track and finish the race out. We did have Buescher lose a tire. Like, there were a few tire failures in this race. Like, it was kind of like Bristol earlier in the spring, but not too egregious. Like, it wasn't like where the tires were just shredded into a fucking million pieces. And honestly, that spring Bristol race, like, it was so fucking, like, Bristol has honestly been so cringe about that spring race to where now they're selling jars of the fucking shredded rubber on their fucking website. What the fuck? That is so fucked up. Like, I'll be honest, that's kind of fucked up. I mean, hey, it could have been worse. It could have been bottles of Chase Elliott's bathwater, but we haven't gone to that point yet. But now that I mention it, I probably just jinxed it, and that's coming up soon. So sorry to everybody for just jinxing it. Very unprofessional on my part. I'm pretty sure that wasn't me. I think I've been reprogrammed by Darian Gilliam to say unprofessional shit and jinx things. God damn it, let me check the back of my neck for a fucking chip. That's, I think Darian fucking hacked into my brain. Damn it. No one's fucking safe. Fuck. But anyway, back to the race though. We then have Kyle Busch have more bad luck, as Busch would then suffer a left rear flat tire, and then as soon as they changed the tire, they realized something was wrong, and something broke on the left rear, and then Busch had to go to the garage to repair. But if you think that luck from Kyle Busch is bad, well, get ready, it's about to get worse. Because literally, moments after they repaired the car and Busch got back on track, literally as soon as he got back on track, the power steering fan belt and the engine broke, and that ended Kyle Busch's night. Good God, Kyle Busch has had the worst fucking luck this year. Jesus Christ. Everything that could go wrong for him has gone wrong. Jesus Christ. See, I wonder why there have been rumors about him possibly going back to JGR after the news of Martin Truex Jr.'s retirement earlier this week came out. Which, honestly, I'm not really surprised about Truex retiring. Like, I knew Truex was going to retire I knew that this year was going to be Truex's last year. Just Truex hasn't been the same since Cole Pern left. But hey, honestly, at least Truex gets to go out on top right and has a chance to go out on top right now. And instead of staying around for way too goddamn long and just skin washed up and looking like a complete shell of himself later on. Like, honestly, I'd rather Truex go out the way he is right now than go out the way of like a Jimmy Johnson or a Tony Stewart or hell, even Dale Jr. Where they just looked washed up in a complete shell of themselves. But yeah, we'll have to see what happens with Kyle Busch. I don't think Kyle Busch is going to JGR. I think he's going to stay at RCR for one more year and exercise that third-year option. If Busch's frustration doesn't reach a goddamn breaking point. But yeah, good God, I'll be honest. I think this might be the first. This could become the first time where Kyle Busch goes winless in the season. Just, he has had some of the worst fucking luck this year. Like, I think Kyle Busch could miss the chase this year and might go winless. It might happen. Will it happen? No, probably not. I think Kyle Busch will find a way to back his way into a win at some point in the year. Like he has always done in the past, he'll always find a way to get at least one win and keep the streak alive. But anyway, back to the race, though. Once Larson went out of the race, It just gave Ryan Blaney an easier path to the win, despite the best efforts from Chase Elliott and William Byron. Even Josh Berry was up there at one point until SHR bad luck kicked in. But yeah, despite the best efforts from Byron and Elliott, just no one was stopping Ryan Blaney. As Blaney had the most dominant performance of his career, leading 201 laps, the first time Blaney has led 200 laps in his career in a cup race. And Blaney wins the inaugural cup race at Iowa. So Ryan Blaney gets his first win of the season, finally. He has his most dominant performance of his career. And all I say for this win as well, we all know Blaney's history when he leads 100 plus laps in a race isn't the best in the world. It's pretty bad. But hey, folks, Blaney's now 1-for-1 when he leads 200 plus laps in a race. No, Blaney's still overrated until he wins a legit title, though. Win a legitimate title and I'll stop calling Blaney overrated. That's the deal. And also good for Blaney, though, to win in front of his 80 family relatives in the crowd. Jesus Christ, that's the third fucking fan takeover we've seen at the track in the last 2 years. First, we had Suarez's Amigos take over Sonoma. And then we had the HMS family take over Martinsville earlier this year for the 40-year anniversary. And that's VIP section up in Turn 2. And now Blaney's family takes over Iowa. God damn, what's next? What's the next fan invasion happening? Elliot's family taking over fucking Atlanta Motor Speedway in September? That might actually not be too far away from the truth, considering it's Chase Elliott. And Elliott is considered Redneck Jesus Jr., so I probably just jinxed that one, too. But yeah, Blaney gets the window. Blaney also gets redemption for what happened at Gateway 2 weeks ago when he had Gateway in the bag until he ran out of gas coming to the white flag because of the Blaney team miscommunication. This time, there was no miscommunication from Blaney and the 12 team as the fuel lived. And yes, Blaney finally saved at the pump for once. In the land of the porn, I mean the corn. I totally meant corn. But yeah, Blaney gets his first win of the season. Even Blaney doing a burnout there when it looked like he was going to save the equipment to be a pussy again. And Blaney's like, psych, I'm going to do a burnout. Honestly, good. Do more burnouts, Blaney. Like, honestly, I like it better when you do burnouts instead of just doing parade lap around like a pussy. Like, honestly, grow some fucking balls, damn it. But yeah, Blaney gets the first win of the year. We'll find out Blaney's fate probably in a couple weeks, because now that's 10 winners on the season with 9 races to go. And if we have no new winners by Nashville or Chicago, we could have all the 1-race winners officially quench their way into the chase by either Nashville or by the Chicago race or even the Brickyard around there. If we don't have a new winner within the neck for the next 3 races. But yeah, Blaney gets the win. And honestly, this race was, I'll say for this race overall, it was easily the best short track race we had this season. Like, it was, like, there were tire issues, but it wasn't as egregious as what Bristol had back in the spring with that chaos. When the tires just give out almost immediately. And it was a lot better than Martinsville and Richmond. Plus, there was really no controversy. I mean, yeah, there was some inconsistent NASCAR officiating, but that can happen almost at any other track under the right circumstances. Same deal with tire issues. Like, honestly, a lot of people point out those 2 issues, but honestly, those are more minor nitpicks, if anything. But overall, Iowa's weekend was a success. I think it was a success. I mean, the fans showed out. It was a packed house. Like, the fans have been waiting a long time for it. They finally got it. I'm glad we got Iowa on the schedule. Like, Iowa 100% this weekend proved they deserved a cup date. And they delivered. So, yeah, a lot of positives to say about Iowa. So, yeah, really good there. You know, hopefully Iowa stays on the schedule for the future. Like, they 100% deserve a cup date. I'm glad it's on the schedule, finally. But, yeah, that was the Iowa weekend. A pretty short recap because not much action happened. Everything happened at Iowa this weekend. We'll have a lot more action, though, next weekend. But anyway, though, before we wrap this up, let's take a look at how the chase standings fare entering Loudon next week. So first off, we're going to take a look at the Xfinity Chase grid standings after Iowa, with now 11 races to go until the Xfinity Chase begins. So of course, four drivers locked in, and those four being Hill, Smith, Mayer, and Fang, and the Kiwi, Shane Van Gisbergen. Allgaier and Jesse Love have one win right now, but a lot of that could change. So they're in the wait-and-see category, because the only way you're truly locked in now is two wins. And then we have the other six spots on points right now, where Cole Custer, he's easily the safest out of all the points guys right now. Like, hell, he's leading the points right now, despite not winning a race. Because Custer's been pretty consistent this year. Then you got Sheldon Creed and Riley Herbst in pretty good positions, 92 and 91 points to good. Then you have the guys within a race of the cut line who are pretty solid right now, but a lot can change in 11 races for Allmendinger, Quiggerman, and Sammy Smith. And then you got the only two guys within a race of the point of the final spot. It's Ryan Sieg and Anthony Alfredo, 31 and 54 out respectively. You know, still pretty early on. A lot can happen these next 11 races. And then everybody else is a full race out. And yeah, Haley Deegan's been pretty bad this year. Like, I think Haley Deegan is reaching bust territory right now. Like, the saddest thing about Deegan is that Matt DiBenedetto is actually higher in points than Haley Deegan right now. And Matt DiBenedetto has missed 8 races this year and isn't even eligible for the Xfinity Chase. Yet he's higher in points than Haley Deegan. Like, that's pretty fucking embarrassing for Deegan. But I'll say for this, though, for all the young female racers looking to get into race seed, don't be a Haley Deegan or a Natalie Decker. Be a Jamie Chadwick. But anyway, that's where the Xfinity Chase stacks up entering New Hampshire next week. And now we get to the Cup Series Chase grid after Iowa. Now we have 9 races remaining until the Cup Series Chase begins. So we only have 4 drivers locked in right now, with Dallas being Larson, Hamlin, Byron, and Bell. Then you got now 6 drivers in the one-win category. All 6 potentially could lock themselves in if we have no new winners within the next 3 weeks. As yet, Elliott Reddick, Blaney, Keselowski, Suarez, and Cindric all have one win. And they're all in that wait-and-see category. And in the last 6 spots on points, the only one that's safe on points right now is Martin Truex Jr., who's 122 to good. But a lot could change, though. Then you got Chastain and Ty Gibbs, 71 and 70 to the good. They're pretty good right now. A lot can change, though, obviously. Especially if some of the cut line wins, that moves that cut line down a lot. And you got Bowman Oswalt race above the cut line, 66 to the good right now. But the last 2 spots is when it gets really dicey. As Buescher, he holds one of the last 2 spots, and he's in a decent position, but 27 points isn't really a safe gap with 9 races remaining. And then Bubba Wallace currently holds the last spot by 6 points. But keep in mind, if we have a new winner in the next 9 weeks, that would knock Bubba Wallace out and put him below the line in the bubble area. As right now, the first guy out on points is Joey Logano, 6 points out. And despite Kyle Busch's bad luck, Busch is still within striking distance of the chase, as he's only 31 points out. But at this rate for Busch, either Busch needs to actually get some good runs going and try and gain some points, or he needs to win a race. And you got Chase Briscoe, who's still within a race of the points lead, as he's 44 points back. And then everybody else from Todd Gilliland on down are over a race out on points. And honestly, I think a lot of them, though, I think the only way they could possibly make their way in is Pastis with a win. And a lot could change, though, because we still have yet Daytona to go. We got a couple other road courses like Chicago coming up. We also got the return of the Brickyard 400, which will create some unpredictability there. But yeah, that's where the Cup Chase stacks up, with 9 races remaining. Anyway, on to New Hampshire next week. Who will be in and who will be out? We'll tune in this summer to find out.